Destin I-4 is about to get a lot worse.
Workers are just beginning a major overhaul. Construction will last for the next 6 years.
It's for the I-4 Ultimate Project.
Expect major delays throughout the afternoon and throughout this area.
We've got slowdowns all the routes down. Eastbound I-4 from Conroy to Colonial. Now westbound I-4, busy spot is the 417 all the way down to Neal Boulevard. That's Z88.3, stress saver traffic.
Well, good morning, Journey. How are we doing? All right. Well, this is a little different for us today out here. We've actually been doing this more this year where we preach about once a month live out here. If you're normally coming or if you're new here today, we're a video venue primarily. So most of the time we're watching a video here, but today you get me. So hopefully this makes some sense today. I don't know. If you have your scriptures, turn to James chapter 1. James chapter 1, we'll be sitting in the midst of the end of that chapter today throughout most of our message this morning. James chapter 1, verse 19 through 25, it says this: "My dear brothers, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but actually doing it, he will be blessed in what he does." As we continue on in our series called Faith Under Construction, we're walking through this whole book of James in the New Testament. We come across this piece of advice again this week. Remember, James is talking to folks that have been scattered throughout the nations, that have taken what little understanding of faith that they've had and gone about into different arenas, different places, and they've been trying to figure it out. And James writes this book to them. So many of these folks are dealing with their own questions, their own issues, and they're trying to maintain their faith in the midst of it, but there's all these different cultures and all these different influences that keep coming into their lives, and so it makes it difficult to remember that foundation. And doesn't that sound very familiar to us? We know the foundation that God has laid for us through his scriptures, and many of us that have grown up in the church and have heard these things before, but now we sit in this world that has such dominating influences into our lives. So many times we just need to get back to some of these basic teachings, these pieces of advice that James can give to us. That's what he does in our book. It calls us back and it lays down some of this practical stuff for us. Remember the beginning of the series, it talked about reducing your speed through our trials. And then last week it was do not enter. And when we're dealing with temptations, we just need to be smart and stay out of those things. And today we talk about yielding, controlling our anger. I looked at this idea of yielding and the yield signs that I see on a regular basis. The one that I see all the time is the one right out here on the outskirts of town on Old 441, right before you get onto 441 now. That's the one where you're coming around this bend, right? And you see this yield sign, but it's kind of far off in the distance. And so what that means to me is that I speed up as fast as I possibly can because the other cars are coming and I want to get there before they get there because I know that they're not going to let me in. So I just lay on the gas. I see the yield sign, but I just go right through it and try not to, you know, mangle anybody on the road. That's what I look at when I see this yield sign. It's almost like a green light on a drag strip or something like that. Whoever gets there first wins the game. And I'm not competitive at all. So that's just kind of how I look at it. But it's a shocker, but that's not really what the yield signs are for. Hopefully you drive a little bit better than me. Just so there's no question about it, Florida Driver's Handbook says this: yield means to slow down and give vehicles crossing your path the right of way. If the way is clear, you may move forward slowly without stopping. In Joel's handbook, it means get there first. Slowing down is the last resort. If you have to slow down or even stop, then you must throw your hands up in the air, let out this huge sigh, and maybe even a come on if you have the feel of it. I mean, whatever you need to do, that's what the yield sign means to me. Because I'm trying to teach other people how to drive while I'm in my vehicle, okay? which really does lead us to the next thing, which is road rage. Each of you, or the person that is either by you or the person that is having trouble learning these lessons, road rage becomes a very serious issue. Article 5.7.1 in the handbook called Aggressive Driving says, road rage is defined as violent or visibly angry behavior by a driver of a motor vehicle, which can result in crashes or other incidents on roadways. Here are the signs of this: sudden acceleration, braking, and closely tailgating, cutting off of other drivers, preventing them from merging, hitting the horn or flashing your lights, shouting obscenities or threats, hand gestures. Now, I don't think they're meaning, hey, you're the greatest driver ever, thanks for cutting me off, okay? I don't think that's what he's talking about there. Getting out of the vehicle and actually starting a confrontation. I have seen this before. Or even threatening somebody with a weapon. That's all considered road rage. I remember I was on an inner city missions trip to Philadelphia. And we were with a group of students and we were going down this one-way, one-vehicle space in the middle of inner-city Philadelphia. Well, we came across this huge pothole. Our 15-passenger van could get through it, but the trailer we were dragging, we knew it was just going to get messed up. So we stop it before the trailer gets there, and me and the youth minister get out, and we go back, and we're trying to figure out how to get the trailer through without totally destroying it. And the guy behind us, who was a very large man, became very agitated quickly. I mean, it escalated. So he was laying on the horn as loud as he could possibly be. His obscenities were louder than his horn, and his hand gestures were just frankly quite scary. Because all of that aside, it was the gun that he had on his steering wheel pointing at us while he's yelling at us with all these things. So we get back there to look at the trailer, and then we hear this guy, and we turn around, and we're like, go, 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 you know, jump back in the van and get the heck out of Dodge, right? We didn't want to have anything to do with that guy. Road rage is something that gets after us pretty quickly. What is it that causes us to just lose our minds in anger? It happens more often than probably we care to admit. But we may not get to the level that this guy did, but we do hit those levels pretty quickly. We go from about 0 to 60 in about less than a second. And you have to answer for yourself, what are those things, what are those catchphrases, what are those incidences that get you to that level? Because you have to be cautious about those things. What are the things that just eat at you left and right? Now, we all have silly things that we can acknowledge pretty easily. They become silly when you talk about them in front of 100 people. But they tend to get us upset very quickly. Myself, there are times when sporting events really dictate my moods. I know, it seems silly standing up here, but that happens on a fairly regular basis. And I got to tell you, being a huge Chicago Cubs fan, this has been a nightmare for years and years and years, okay? It's been a struggle. I should probably have stopped watching baseball 20 years ago, but I'm addicted to it, and I watch, and now I'm watching the Cubs on the computer, and it aggravates me. It gets to me. You might think that Disney World is the happiest place on earth. But let me tell you this, if you are having to push a double stroller through Disney World with three kids, not two, three, so somebody's holding one, the other one is pushing the double stroller, it can become a nightmare very, very quickly. There's people that just cut you off left and right, and they just could care less. They could give a rip about your family because they are there to have their perfect vacation, and you're there, and you're just trying to survive the day. This is Disney World, the happiest place on earth. And for the love, people, if you are walking somewhere where you don't know where you are and you stop in the middle of the walkway and try to figure it out with thousands of people behind you, most likely the first person behind you will be me and my double stroller. Now, when you stop, I usually try almost break my wrist trying to move that bad boy out of the way and get around you. And then you'll hear this grumbling from me when I go, don't stop in the middle, don't stop in the middle. Because I'm just trying to protect you and not slam into your ankles. But really deep down inside, what I'd like to do is just plow into you and teach you a lesson. I mean, that's really how my mind is working, and my anger just starts going crazy, and maybe I'm by myself, but there are things that just get after me, and you're starting to go, I don't think I'm really on board with my pastor here. He's got some big problems, I know, but let me tell you this. This is kind of how it works in my life. I was very guarded with it this week, but this week, we went to the outlet malls on Tuesday, one of my most hated places in the world, with the double stroller. We went to Disney on Wednesday, and I love Disney, but traveling through Disney drives me up a wall. On Tuesday morning, I somehow erased half of my sermon for this weekend. And on top of all of that, my in-laws were in town for 10 days. 10 days. We slept upstairs on an air mattress while they had our bedroom and our bathroom. And, you know, it was actually a great time visiting with them. But that stuff just kind of gets at you, doesn't it? I mean, don't admit that right now, but it does, okay? It really starts to get at you. And so what we need to do as people that are trying to follow after God better, and one of the things that James tells us is we need to just recognize our anger. We need to recognize the things that get after us, the things that cause us to go from 0 to 60. The Institute of Basic Life Principles writes on their website that anger is a universal problem. It's not limited to one age group, culture, race, economic level, social status, educational background, or any other classification. Unresolved anger is one of the chief contributing factors to the destruction of marriages, the breakdown of families, and the weakening of communities. It is a major cause of health problems and lack of productivity in the workplace, and it is a common denominator among juvenile delinquents. This is a problem, not just for me, not just for us, but for everyone. We all struggle with this from time to time. Even the calmest of us will wrestle through sometimes when we are battling our anger. We need to recognize what those things are. James understood this, and I would bet that he probably struggled with it because he reminds us of this at the beginning of our text. He just says, take a breath. Take a moment and slow down. Verse 19b says, everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For a lot of us, the adjectives are actually completely reversed. We're really slow to listen, quick to speak, and even quicker to become angry. He says to just stop a second. Stop living a life in the fast lane. Because when you're living a life at such high speeds and everything is go, 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 your reaction times suffer. And that's when difficult things will come into your life because you can't turn when you need to turn. But you start running through those stop signs and you don't even see those yield signs anymore. And your anger just slowly starts to deteriorate any compassion that you would have for any other people in this world. And sometimes it can cause abrupt accidents in your life that will be the hardest thing for you to recover from for the longest time in your journey. You see, when you are slow to speak or slow to listen and quick to speak, it can communicate that everyone else's words are not nearly as important as your own words. That's what it says to people around you. And when your anger continues to spike again and again and again without warning, it can communicate that you really do think that you are the center of the universe. It can become it's my way or the highway, and I just don't care anymore. And that comes across in everything that we would do. But aside from these literal temper tantrums that we have, I know I have them, and they occur so easily, it seems, the relationship damage that it causes, that's the biggest problem. That's what James says in our text here. In verse 20, he says, "For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires." Not dealing with our anger and not recognizing our anger and letting it boil again and again and again is leading us farther and farther away from our Creator. Remember Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7? I put a picture up here for you guys to see. This is the picture of the Mount of Beatitudes. It's kind of overlooking the Sea of Galilee. We saw this just a month or so ago when we were there. And there's this huge kind of cathedral-looking embankment on this mount as you head up to the church that has been built there and the gardens that are around it. And I thought it was just an incredible amphitheater to see where Jesus most likely would have shared this sermon for everybody. But he says these words in the Sermon on the Mount, on top of this ridge, potentially. He says in Matthew 5, 7, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God." Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. If you're seeking out peace in your life and seeking to make peace in the lives of those around you, then you'll start to reflect that character of God, to be called a son of God, to begin that righteous life that God desires of us. That you'll be a representative that God is looking for in each and every one of us that claim Jesus as our Savior. How incredible would it have been to be on the boat on the Sea of Galilee when that huge storm comes raging up in Matthew chapter 8 and Mark chapter 4. The seasoned fishermen were scared to death. They had never seen a storm like this, which was taught to us while we were there. You see, they see storms all the time, and it says that the storms will just come up really quickly on the Sea of Galilee. But this says these fishermen, these trained men, were so scared to death they had no idea what to do, which means that this storm was some sort of supernatural thing happening. Something was coming upon these fishermen, this boat and this journey. And then Jesus, who is asleep in the bottom of the boat, comes up. They wake him up. They're like, we're all going to die. And what does Jesus say? He says, peace, be still, quiet, be still. And I can only imagine that he very could have just pointed up to the hillside and said, remember what I told you. Remember what I've taught you. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. We have to recognize those things that make us angry, those things that really get after us. We have to acknowledge them and be aware of them so we can be on guard for them. And James goes on to say in verse 21, therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. The second thing we need to do is we need to rid ourselves of evil. We all need to rid ourselves of evil. In the original text, these words draw us to the visual of clothing. It's a putting on and a taking off type of metaphor. To get rid is essentially to take off or to strip off all of those things that have made us filthy, those things that have made us dirty. It was very much echoing the language that Paul would have used in the book of Ephesians when he talks about putting on the armor of God and guarding ourselves from the things of the world. Ephesians chapter 4, it says, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, to rid yourself of these things, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, not the desires of God, to be made new in the attitude of your minds and to put on the new self. Clothe yourself in these new things, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Caden and Carolina, our two oldest children, they are both currently playing T-ball over in Apopka. I think we got, yeah, there they are. Carolina's a giant child, by the way. And they've done pretty well with it. They seem to enjoy it. They have a good time. Carolina has played one more season than Caden, and she's really done well. However, if you were to ask Caden today, what is the number one rule in T-ball? He'll say this, don't play in the dirt. Aside from hitting the ball, catching the ball, throwing the ball, running, none of which any of the children do very well, the number one rule that he would say is don't play in the dirt, because this is one of those things that for some reason just drives me up a wall. I'm a former wannabe baseball player. I got to play through college. I never played when I was little, so I don't understand the dynamic. And to watch kids roll around on the infield during the game and play in the dirt just drives me up a wall, and it gets me so bent out of shape. I become that dad on the sidelines. Carolina never had an issue with it. Caden, always, every game. Just yesterday, we had issues with this. But before each game, we go over it, and for some reason, he gets out there, and this incredible beautiful dirt on the infield and on the pitcher's mound just draws him in. He cannot stay away. It's so enticing to him, he just can't resist. I watched him one game kneel down. He actually did this again yesterday. Kneel down on every bag while he's running the bases, and do this, start making dirt angels in the dirt around the bag. And I'm like, oh no, here we go again, right? So I start to get agitated. Well, the worst one was at the end of last season. We'd spent the whole year trying to get him to not play in the dirt. Last game, he just could care less. He's standing out on the pitcher's mound. He's got his hat off, and he is putting dirt in his hat. And he's filling this thing. And I'm like, I do the dad holler, Caden, you know, from the sidelines. And all the other parents are like, uh-oh, here we go. Pastor's getting angry, you know. Caden, yeah, what are we not supposed to do? Don't play in the dirt. Yeah, buddy, what are you doing? And he just stares at me. And it wasn't defiant or anything. He just stared at me and like he was caught red-handed. And he just puts his hat on. And it just splew all over the place. Dirt everywhere. I mean, uniform is just a mess. And he's like, you know, puts his thumb up. Okay, buddy, thank you. I appreciate you making that happen for me. He literally just took a shower in dirt that day. And most every game we come back, he is just filthy from playing in the dirt. He doesn't slide. He just plays in the dirt. Now, that's funny for all of you guys, but it really does get under my skin, and I've had a couple of therapy sessions to try to deal with that anger. I'm doing okay with it. The reality is this is exactly what we do on a regular basis. There's all this dirt and filth that this world is throwing at us. We are surrounded by on a regular basis. It is so prevalent in our lives. Every time we walk out the door, every time we get up in the morning, we're surrounded by such beautiful filth that it entices us in, and we mess with it again and again and again. Sometimes just dabbling in it, sometimes just messing with it. Sometimes we do some of this stuff, but sometimes we just dump it over our heads and go, oh, we just don't care anymore. It's exactly what we do with the filth of this world. Sometimes it's the trials that get to us. Sometimes it's the tests that get to us. And sometimes it's the temptations that get to us, all of which potentially lead us down a road to anger that we cannot ignore anymore. As Christ followers, we have to recognize this and try to get rid of this stuff as best as possible. Proverbs 22 says, "Do not make friends with a hot-tempered man. Do not associate with one easily angered, or you may learn his ways and get yourself ensnared." You see, even some people that we hang around on a regular basis take us farther and farther down the road of not being peacemakers. So we have to understand that. Let the things that we can control coming into our lives, the things that come into our homes through TV and through internet, through friends and through family, all these important things that are coming in, all these things that are important to our minds, we have to do a better job of getting rid of those things out of our lives because they are drawing us farther and farther away from God. What James is saying is that we need to get as much of this stuff as we can away. And how do we do that? How do we do that? Look at our text again. Verse 21b says this, "Humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does." What we should be doing is diving into our scriptures. Diving into God's word. We have to be both hearers and doers of the words of God. It's actually been a very interesting dynamic as the generations continue to go by. There are generations and generations that only dove into God's word and knew it backwards and forwards, but neglected doing anything about it. And then there are whole generations right now that are coming up that everything is experiential and everything is have to be out and doing things, so much so that a lot of times the very name of Jesus and the words of God get taken away from it, and we're not doing either properly. What James is saying here is that we have to find a balance and a medium in talking about doing and hearing together in our walk with Jesus. We're going to be talking about this in a couple of weeks, but we have to do both. If we're not doing both, it's like looking in a mirror, remember our text? And walking away and forgetting immediately what we look like. It's like walking into a room to get something and not remembering why exactly you walked into that room. Isn't that frustrating? It's like making a phone call and then forgetting why you needed to talk to those people. It's like worshiping God in this place and then worshiping the creation outside of this place. Hear this, we have to be both involved in God's word and involving God's word in our lives. We have to be both involved in God's word and involving God's word in our lives, hearers and doers. Remember the story of Jonah and the big fish in the Old Testament. After God decides to show the city of Nineveh grace and spare it, Jonah just can't handle it, and his anger gets the best of him. Maybe you don't remember that part of the story, but Jonah chapter 4 usually isn't taught on the flannel graph in Sunday school. I had to learn that one as I grew up in the faith. But what happens is Jonah just gets angry at God. And why? He says this, "I know that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love." That's why Jonah was mad, because God was gracious and God was compassionate. He was slow to anger and abounding in love. And God, slow to being angry, threw Jonah over the edge, and he started questioning everything. He literally asked God to kill him because he can't handle the ridiculousness of God's love. And God simply asked him this, I love this, have you any right to be angry? Have you any right to be angry? A simple phrase that we need to ask ourselves, have I any right to be angry over this situation or that situation or what's come my way? Do I have a right to be angry for those things? In 1 Corinthians 13, while Paul's reflecting on love, he says, it is not easily angered. Another simple phrase for us to ask is, am I showing love? Am I showing love? Do I have a right to be angry? And am I actually showing love to my wife, to my children, to everyone that I come in contact with? This passage was read at our wedding. It was so cute. We had two junior high girls up there, and they went back and forth reading the whole chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians, but it gets to this, and it's not easily angered. And sometimes that gets thrown out the window in all of our relationships. It's something that we continue to struggle with. Matthew 5:22. Back in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount that we mentioned earlier, Jesus is in Galilee. He says, but I tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. You see, there are consequences to our anger getting the best of us. And not just in this world, but there's an awaiting judgment for those that never rid themselves of these anger issues, that don't ever seek repentance. There will be judgment on us. Is what scripture says, is what Jesus said. Ephesians 4:26 gives another practical thing for us. It says, in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. I always thought that this was just something that smart people said for marriage advice. When you're doing premarital counseling, don't ever go to bed without talking out your disputes. Don't ever go to bed angry. It's actually the words of God through his scriptures. When we do this, when we walk away from a fight and just stew in our anger, it's actually giving the schemer an open door to get into our minds and get into our thoughts. But what do you notice about all of these scriptures as we dive into God's word and start reading a little bit more about it? What do you notice? Anger is a part of our lives. It's always going to be there in some form or another. It's inevitable that we'll have to deal with it. So how can we get to this idea of a righteous anger that Jesus displays? You know, I can't get through a message on anger without telling you how Jesus dealt with some of his anger. Because yes, he did have anger come up. There were some angry moments in his public ministry. And there's probably a lot more angry moments that weren't divulged in our scriptures that Jesus had to deal with. And so in Mark chapter 3, it tells when he was angered with the Pharisees. When they questioned him about healing a man on the Sabbath, it says that he was angered in that. That makes sense. That seems to be a righteous anger. In Mark chapter 3, it tells us that in Matthew chapter 23, he wasn't pleased with the Pharisees again. And the whole discourse on woe to you, Pharisees, woe to you, preachers, woe to you, all these religious leaders, all of those woes were given with an angst to it, an anger to it from Jesus. And even when he was rebuking Peter in Matthew chapter 16, there's some aggression in that. But the most familiar is in John chapter 2, that passage when he's cleansing the temple. It's probably the most aggressive that we see Jesus in our texts. John chapter 2, verse 14 through 16, it says, in the temple courts he found men selling cattle, sheep and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple area, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, get these out of here, exclamation point. How dare you turn my father's house into a market, exclamation point. You see, Jesus came at these folks with some righteous, with some holy anger. Mark Mora, a New Testament scholar, painted a great picture of this. I wanted to share it with you. He says, as Jesus walked into the temple, it looked and smelled like a hybrid stockyard / circus. There would be blood splattered about the altar, oxen and sheep lowing, birds cooing, squawking, and flitting about when they were manhandled. There would have been people from all over the Roman world that brought their vacation money with them in a desire to make a sacrifice to God. The whole spectacle came to be known as the Bazaar of Annas, who was the Jewish high priest. Here's how it would have worked. If a worshiper brought in an animal to be sacrificed, the officiating priest would undoubtedly have found something wrong with it and offered to buy it from him at a reduced price. The animal would then be taken back to the pens of the priest, blessed, and sold to another worshiper at an inflated price. The original worshiper then had to purchase a kosher animal at an exorbitant price, sometimes 4 to 5 times its actual value, in order to do his sacrifice. And when he pulled his money out of his pocket, if it wasn't Palestinian coinage, he would have had to exchange it and go to the money changer for proper currency. And when he did, he was charged a 15 to 20% fee with that as well. It was quite the setup, wasn't it? And on top of that, every Jew was required to pay a temple tax annually. It really was functioning as kind of this huge, corrupt central bank in those days. All of the visitors would have been bitter when they came to give sacrifices to God. And they didn't have a choice if they wanted to fulfill what they believed they should be doing. And to make matters worse, there were no fees, no set fees for any of this that was going on. It was all up for grabs, depending on the mood of the people that were there that day. So there was constant and heated haggling over prices. Faces were red, fists were clenched, and voices were raised, all for the worship of God. Doesn't it sound like just an inviting place? It was a mess, and it needed a cleansing, don't you think? And Jesus comes in flipping tables and taking names. It's great because even in the language that's used there, it's a passage of him driving people out like the good shepherd that he would become, like the good shepherd metaphor that he would use. He was driving out the people. He was driving out the cattle. His sheep had gone astray, and he needed to get them back into line. He was making a statement about who he was, and there was authority by which he was coming. His righteous anger is revealed when he took care of those that couldn't take care of themselves. And maybe didn't even know that they were being taken advantage of. And made sure that worshiping God was a priority, not something to be taken lightly and not influenced, interpreted, or changed by our world. I believe that's why we see James finish off our section of scripture in verse 27. He says, "Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world." You want to make God angry? Mess with his people. And when I say his people, I mean everyone on the planet. God desires everybody to come to relationship with him. And so you start messing with people and you'll start to see a righteous anger from God. You want to make God angry? Pollute the world with thoughts and philosophies contrary to his scriptures and his words. That's going to make God angry. When you begin to weigh our anger against the righteous anger of the triune God, most of it falls under this silly category. Most of it just is a reflection of how selfish we have truly become and how much this world has influenced us in how we act and how we behave. And when your anger begins to fall in line with this righteous anger of God, then you better do something about it, because remember, we are hearers of the word and doers of the word. Let your righteous anger, we've got to get it to righteous anger first. Let your righteous anger spur you to actions that honor God. Let your anger get to that righteous level first, but then you've got to do something about it. But then what you do has to be honoring to God. It just can't be something where you try to wipe something out. It has to be an honoring thing to God. Let your righteous anger spur you on to actions that honor God. If the orphan crisis makes you angry, then you should be doing something about that. If seeing starving children makes you angry, then you should be doing something about that. If false teachings and doctrines contrary to scripture make you angry, then get up and do something about it. If senseless violence makes you angry, then do something about it. If lost and lonely people make you angry, then you need to be doing something about it. And if none of that makes you angry, then maybe we need to dive into God's word a little bit more and actually reflect on how closely we are walking with Jesus. Because there's a righteous anger that drives us to actions that honors God. Since John's message last week came down to a simple phrase of be smart. Remember that, be smart in your temptations. When we're dealing with all that, I wanted to make this week simple as well as we're dealing with anger. And that is be prepared. Be prepared for what this world is going to throw at you. Be prepared in how you react and what drives you to anger. Be prepared as you slowly try to get rid of all these things that the world is throwing your way. And be prepared by diving into God's word again and again and again. If we're going to be a people that are controlling our anger, then we need to be prepared for when it comes and be able to check ourselves against the desires of God. And here's the visual. Here's our visual with our yield signs. You see, there'll be a yield sign that you see on a regular basis, and if it doesn't have words on it, this one does, but it means to proceed slowly. And we see it all the time. Proceed slowly, because there may be some difficulties coming in your life. You need to go slowly through this place. The second one is this. It's the right of way. It reminds us that we need to give others the right of way in our lives. Putting them first, acknowledging their needs before our own, and guarding our anger against those things that are so selfish, so self-focused. And finally, the last yield sign. I wish we had these in our lives. I love this. Yield ahead. There's a yield ahead. And know that there are going to be times when life is difficult and gets extremely upset. It gets you extremely upset and hurt and angry. We have to be prepared for that. Know that Jesus has gone through all of this with us and shown us how to get through it through his righteous anger and his actions accordingly. Be prepared to lean on him, lean on his word, because quite simply, it goes back to the very beginning. My dear brothers, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. For man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. If you would, please stand with me as we close out in prayer this morning. God, thank you for today. Thank you for the opportunity to be real in the midst of a life that throws us a lot of difficult things. God, thank you for the opportunities to recognize those little things that we make into huge things. And God, I pray that you would give us the courage to seek out your words. God, to seek out what you would have us to do in the midst of difficulties, in the midst of hard times, things that would spur us on towards anger. God, help us to detour that into righteous anger, that we might respond and react in the way that your son would. God, I pray that you would help us to yield in this life. Yield to your word. Yield to your leadership. God, yield to those around us. Let us put others ahead of ourselves. God, help us to be people that are living that righteous life that you so desire for us. God, give us the strength, give us the courage to do that in the midst of all the difficulties. God, help us to control our anger. We love you, God. We thank you. It's in your son's name that I pray. Amen.